Appreciate so very much the opportunity to come again, to be a part with the congregation here and all the good brethren that are associated with this, and as both as speakers and... Again, to say, we're again especially associated with those who are the speakers in relationship to this. Appreciate the elders, Brother Hatcher, giving the invitation to come again and to be with us. I didn't hear the morning sessions this morning. We talked about last night, Brother Daniel's manuscript. I would like to have one about his size when I started hunting material myself. Our subject this evening deals with the thought of fellowship and the Lord's Supper. You may have, and I may have turned it off. All right. Again, we do appreciate that. And our fellowship, I and Brother Noah last night gave us a very splendid lesson on what fellowship is. And I thought last night when he and Brother Cates got through, I could stand up and say, I've been here, and sat back down, and y'all have already heard my lesson. fellowship, and probably, is a part of the Lord's church that we do not appreciate as we ought. The true fellowship we have with Christ, with one another, it is a very precious thing and can be very fragile depending upon how one lives in relationship with God. We enjoy fellowships in many realms, but the greatest fellowship that anyone can enjoy is that fellowship of being a child of God and having fellowship with other Christians and with God and with Jesus Christ, His Son. First century Christians continued in this fellowship, Acts chapter 2 and verse 42, and it's a serious thing to lose part in that fellowship. Others have spoken about what the word fellowship means. Let me just briefly, in the beginning of the lesson this evening, make mention of those facts again, and the verb and the noun form of the word fellowship. Kaneo and Kanea, they are defined as to be a partaker, to communicate, to distribute, to come into communion or fellowship with, to become a sharer, or to be made a partner in, to enter into fellowship, to join oneself as an associate, to make oneself a sharer or a partner. And then also in the noun form, fellowship, association, communion, joint participation, the share which one has anything, the participation, the intercourse, the fellowship, the intimacy of fellowship one with another. We think about this relationship, as my topic is this evening, of fellowship and the Lord's Supper. We think about the meaning of the word fellowship, and we understand the significance or the importance that these two subjects can have one with another. But let me, in the beginning of the discussion this evening, make a disclaimer. That is, let me say, first of all, what this lesson is not. This lesson is not a discussion of the denominational topic of open and closed fellowship. When you get in the denominational world, you run into a teaching of closed or strict fellowship and a discussion of open fellowship. And the closed fellowship is those who teach and practice such as the limiting of the partaking of the Lord's Supper to only those in their particular religious faith and doctrine. Now, open fellowship in that is that they open it up to anyone and everyone that might come along and participate therein. And this doctrine of open or closed fellowship hinges around their understanding and teaching of the role of baptism, whether it is a sacrament or just a church ordinance, or whether indeed it is a condition of discipleship. Now we must understand that we must teach the truth. in relationship to the subject of the Lord's Supper, as we must teach and practice the truth on any subject. But we are not police of the fellowship or the Lord's Supper in the Lord's church. We're not police of the communion of Jesus Christ. The truth is that the Bible teaching is neither the teaching of the open or the closed fellowship as is taught in the denominational world. It is the Lord's Supper. It is the Lord's table, and He hath neither invited those who have never obeyed the gospel, nor particularly forbids them of partaking thereof. If one outside the body of Christ does partake of the Lord's Supper, that does not bring one into communion with Christ if that individual has never obeyed the gospel. That individual simply partakes of that much bread and that much fruit of the vine. One who is known not to be a child of God in our midst certainly should be taken aside and privately sit down with and taken the Word of God, and to show that individual the teaching of God's Word in relationship to the New Testament church, in relationship to the Lord's Supper, and the points that are involved with that, and the fellowship that's involved with the taking of the Lord's Supper and being of the Lord's kingdom, that one should be taught the way of the Lord more perfectly. We have not, we will not walk the aisles of our services and sit down and question the faithfulness or the membership of every individual that comes into our services on any particular Lord's Day. This lecture will be on the role of the Lordship and what the fellowship and the role it has with the Lord's Supper as pertains to those who are outside the body of Christ who teach and practice religious error, and even those within the Lord's church who practice error, teach error, and persist in so teaching when confronted with that error, will not repent and leave the error that they are involved in. Let's look then at the subject, the Lord's Supper, or fellowship, and the Lord's Supper. Let me begin by taking notice of the meaning of the Lord's Supper itself. Because it is the purpose and the meaning of the Lord's Supper that makes it play a role in association with fellowship. Of course, the Lord's Supper was instituted by Christ at the Passover feast, the night of His betrayal, Matthew chapter 26, verses 20 through 29. Its meaning and purpose are very closely related. The Passover feast, of course, was the Jewish remembrance of God sparing the firstborn of the children of Israel as they prepared to depart out of the Egyptian bondage. And we find in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, that Christ is our Passover. And the elements, or some of the elements, of that Passover feast, the unleavened bread and the fruit of the vine, are the elements that Jesus took and used to institute the Lord's Supper, and that unleavened bread and fruit of the vine are those which represent the body of Christ and the blood of Christ that was given for us upon the cross of Calvary. Its meaning, then, is to represent Christ's body and His blood that was given and shed for us upon the cross of Calvary. Its purpose is to call our remembrance to the sacrifice that Jesus made for us upon the cross of Calvary. Jesus showed this in the instituting of the Lord's Supper there in Matthew and Mark and Luke and the accounts given therein, as He took each element and as He blessed it and gave the disciples, saying, "This is my body," or "This is my blood." The Apostle Paul reemphasized this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 when he said, "For I have received the Lord, that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He brake it and said, 'Take ye, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.' And after the same manner also He took the cup, and after He had supped, saying, 'This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do as oft you drink in remembrance of me. For as oft as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until He come.'" And He goes on to say that whosoever would eat of that bread and drink of that cup of the Lord unworthy would be guilty of the body and the blood of Christ. And Paul goes on to give a very strong warning to those of the church at Corinth and to all of us today, that when we assemble around the Lord's Supper and we forget the purpose for which we are so assembled, that we do, as Paul said, we drink damnation unto our own selves, not discerning the Lord's body. And that would indicate then that indeed that this act of worship is significant enough and important enough to be will play a part in our fellowship with others. Any role that the Lord's Supper and fellowship have will relate to the meaning and the purpose of the Lord's Supper that we just discussed. That which hinders or prevents our partaking of the Lord's Supper in a biblical manner would play a part or hinder our being able to fellowship those who so practiced and so taught those things that would prevent of our taking of the Lord's Supper in the way that God has instructed and the manner and the purpose for which God instructed that we so take. That would cover two areas. First of all, those who outside the body of Christ teach false teaching and practice religious practices that do not directly relate to the Lord's Supper itself. And secondly, it would cover those teachings or practices of error that do have a direct association with the Lord's Supper. Scriptures dealing directly with this topic within the page of God's Word are very limited. And as I indicated in some opening remarks, that there were not a lot of brotherhood writings that I could find that deal specifically with this topic. We have turned then to the Word of God. And I turn first of all to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning with verse 15. In which the Apostle Paul writes, the church of Corinth said, I speak as to wise men. Judge ye what I say. This cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of Christ? And the bread we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we being many are one bread and one body, for we partake of that one bread. Behold, Israel after the flesh, are not they which eat partakers of the altar? What shall I say then? That the idol is anything, or that which is offered in sacrifice to idols anything? But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils, and not to God. I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils. Ye cannot drink of the cup of the Lord and the cup of the devils. Ye cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and partakers of the devil's table. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 15 through 21. The Apostle Paul, in these verses, sets forth the foundation for the first part of our discussion on talking about those who teach or practice things that are not in keeping with God's Word, that do not directly relate to the Lord's Supper itself. The Apostle Paul, in writing to the church at Corinth here, makes reference of those at Corinth going into their services in the Lord's church and sitting down and partaking of the Lord's table, taking of the fruit of the vine and the unleavened bread that represented the body and the blood of Christ. And then, outside the services, going into the places where things were being sacrificed to idols, and sitting down and eating those meats or those things that were sacrificed to idols, giving attention or allegiance to the fact that these were things sacrificed to idols. Now, Paul said if they had ate of those things that were sacrificed to idols, and they just ate of it as meat, they just took of it as food, and did not associate that which they had eaten, that which they had were partaking of, they did not associate it with the idol itself, that there would have been no problem. But the problem was in associating it with the idol, and then taking the Lord's Supper and associating it with the Lord's Supper. Paul says in verse 16, This cup of blessing that we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? And the bread that we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? I wonder how often today in our services that members of the church partake of those emblems and never give serious consideration to the act that they're engaging in. This was the problem at Corinth. They were making a common meal out of it. I wonder how many times we partake of it today. Well, we've just partaken of some unleavened bread. We just drank of the fruit of the vine. And never give serious consideration to the fact that this is an association, this is a communion, a fellowship that we have with Christ and His shed blood and His given body upon the cross of Calvary. Now Paul, having said this, went on to illustrate the association that we do have with Christ by giving the illustration of those under the Mosaic law, that those who partook of the meat of the sacrifices that were offered under the Judaistic teaching, he said these were partakers of the altar. What Paul was saying is that when we partake of the fruit of the vine, we partake of the bread, that we're partakers of the sacrifice of Christ that was given upon the cross of Calvary. And if we do that and go out and associate them with those who would teach false doctrine, we would be trying to have fellowship with Christ at one time and with the world or with Satan at another. The writers of the International Bible Standard Encyclopedia on pages 688 and 689 make the comment that the acts of fellowship mentioned in the New Testament are four kinds. It said they are the Lord's Supper, communism, contributions, and cooperation. Here are the comments in relationship to the area of fellowship of the Lord's Supper. Quote, our information concerning the nature of the fellowship involved in the service of this sacrament is confined to the single notice in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, or chapter 10, verses 16 and 17. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? Owing to the presence of the material elements in the sacrament, there is a temptation to limit the word for communion to the sense of partaking. He said, this, however, does not entirely satisfy the requirements of the context. And the full significance of the term is to be sought in light of the whole section, that is, verses 14 through 22. By partaking of the cup and the bread, the communicants are linked together in unity. We who are many are one bread, one body, for we all partake of that one bread. End quote. That is, they said, when we take of that bread, we have that unity that is brought about in the fellowship of partaking of those sacraments that represent the body and the blood of Christ given upon the cross of Calvary. As St. Paul directly relates this to the actual sacrifice of idols. But it does no injustice to the Scriptures to relate this also to false teaching. Let me build that case by making mention of a few scriptures. In Matthew chapter 6 and verse 24, Jesus said we cannot serve two masters. We must make a choice of whom we will serve. In Matthew chapter 12 and verse 30, Jesus makes the statement that those who are not for Him are against Him. That is, we cannot serve Christ and the devil and be pleasing to both. And if we are not serving Christ with our all, then we are against Him. In Romans chapter 6, verse 16, the Apostle Paul says the same thing in different words when he says, do you not know, do you not understand that you are the servant, the one to whom you yield yourself servants to obey? Then Jesus in John 8 and verse 44 told the Jews that were present before Him on that occasion that they were of their father the devil, because they would not hear nor receive him and his teachings. He said, you're of the devil. You're the children of the devil. You're a child of the devil because you will not receive the truth. Because you will not accept me as the Son of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 12 through 15, the Apostle Paul speaks of false teachers as being Satan's ministers who fashion themselves as ministers of righteousness. Paul said those who would go out and teach false teachings, they profess themselves to be the servants of God, yet they are in truth the ministers of Satan. And Paul gives charge to those of the church at Rome in Romans chapter 16 and verse 17, that we are to mark them which cause division and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you have learned, and avoid them. These points that we just made, beginning with Jesus' statement in Matthew 6, that we cannot serve two masters, down to Paul's warning that we are not to associate with those and withdraw fellowship from those who teach things that are not sound doctrine. These things being true, can we any more partake of the spiritual table of devils? That is, can we any more associate with false teachers and fellowship them and be pleased and accepted with God than we could if we went out like the Gentiles or like those of the church at Corinth and go out and literally partake of that which is offered to physical idols? Would we be any more acceptable to God if we did? Can we not apply the teachings of the oneness and the unity that's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 6? 10 verses 15 through 21 on the fellowship of the Lord's Supper to false teachers today who threaten that unity? If we fellowship those who practice false doctrines, are we not seeking unity with them? When we have congregations that invite those that they know are teaching and practicing things that are contrary to the Word of God, yet they invite them to their services, to hold meetings, or into lectureships, are we not saying we want a fellowship? That we want a unity with you? If we know beforehand that these are false teachers? These points being undeniable, then, if we fellowship those who are in open rebellion to God and to His Word by teaching error, are we not participants in their error? 2 John verses 9 through 11. If we have fellowship with them, then we would be seeking to have communion with Christ and the church on one hand, and in taking the Lord's Supper and the fellowship with false teachers on the other hand at the same time. This is exactly what the Apostle Paul was condemning in 1 Corinthians chapter 16. Consider what Jerome in his commentary says about the oneness and unity of the faithful in partaking of the Lord's Supper. Beginning his commentary on verse 16 in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, he says, the cup of blessing, the third ritual cup of the Passover meal over which the ritual thanksgiving was pronounced, was called the cup of blessing, the bread which we break. The early Christians called the Eucharist the breaking of bread. And let me insert here that Bible nowhere calls it the Eucharist. And this is a doctrine or teaching of men. And there's a misuse of the word thanksgiving to so call the Lord's Supper the Eucharist. But this is Jerome's comment in relationship to it. He said to call it the breaking of bread, the communion. Through the eating of bread and the drinking of cup, Christians are united to Christ in intimate fellowship. Because the Eucharist's body and His blood, 1 Corinthians 11, verses 27 through 31. From this Eucharistic fellowship with Christ follows the real union of all the faithful with one another in one body. Baptism incorporates the Christian into that one body of the risen Lord. End of quote. That fellowship that we enjoy in the Lord's Supper, in partaking of the one bread and the one cup, is a fellowship with the body of Christ. And the fellowship with Him, we have to abide within His teaching. To walk with Him in the light, as was mentioned last night. Therefore, first of all, if we have fellowship, the fellowship of the Lord's Supper is linked together in the fact that we cannot fellowship those who would teach false teaching and be partakers of the Lord's Supper and be in fellowship with Christ at the same time. Secondly, from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 20 through 34, we find the biblical foundation for the second part of the thought, that is, the fellowship and its role with the Lord's Supper as relates to those who teach false doctrines that directly relate to the Lord's Supper itself. We're familiar with the text of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, where the Apostle Paul makes mention of the fact that the statements were made, quoted by Matthew. He said, "What have ye not houses to drink in, or despise ye the church of God, and shame them which have not? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not. For I receive the Lord, that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord the same night which betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you, this do in remembrance of me. That same manner also he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as oft as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do sue the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a man examine himself, and so let him take of this bread and the cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 22 through 29. Paul's primary concern of the church at Corinth was the manner or the purpose for which they were taking of the Lord's Supper. They were making a common meal of it, rather than doing it in remembrance of Christ's shed blood and his broken body upon the cross of Calvary. And he makes it plain to them that in their forgetting of this and partaking of it in an unworthy manner, that they were displeasing to God. So displeased, said, that they were bringing damnation upon themselves, not discerning the Lord's body. The Bible purpose of our partaking of it is that remembrance of Christ's shed blood and his body given for us upon the cross of Calvary, to bring about the forgiveness of our sins and to purchase the church over which he is head and Savior. To make a common meal of the Lord's Supper as the Corinthians did is to forget that purpose. Any other act, any other teaching or practice that we would do outside the teaching of God's Word would also bring about the same results. To consider the Lord's Supper, let us just for a moment or two deal with some of those who teach false teachings regard to the Lord's Supper itself. As I said, it was instituted by the Lord at the Passover feast, the night before his crucifixion, Matthew chapter 26, Mark chapter 14. Instituted the Lord's Supper, Jesus said that the bread was his body and the cup was his blood, which was shed. Again, as Paul further emphasized this point, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 25. Nothing can take the place of these two elements, the bread and the fruit of the vine. If we were to fellowship those who would change these elements, we would be fellowshipping those who would change the whole meaning and purpose of the Lord's Supper. Yet there are those who would advocate, well, that other elements can be used. Yet there would be those who would seek to change those elements, be outside of God's teaching, outside of God's Word, and thus would have to be outside of the fellowship that we could extend to them. Another teaching of the Scripture of the Lord's Supper is the day of His observance. The Bible teaches by example and necessary emphasis that the Lord's Supper is to be taken by the saints each first day of the week. That first day of the week was the day of the Lord's resurrection. Luke chapter 24 and verse 1. And John chapter 20 and verse 1. On the day of Pentecost, the day after the seventh Sabbath, that is on the Lord's day, the first day of the week, 3,000 souls were added to the church after hearing the sermon preached by Peter on the day of Pentecost. In Acts chapter 2 and verse 42, the church was continuing steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and the breaking of bread. To be able to continue into a practice has to be in existence. The church of Troas came together upon the first day of the week to break bread. Paul implies the primary purpose of the church coming together at Corinth on the first day of the week, again, was to partake or to eat of the Lord's Supper. One cannot find any reference to the Scriptures and any practice of the first century church taking the Lord's Supper on any other day except the first day of the week. Any person, religious body, partakes of the Lord's Supper any other day, thus or without Bible authority. And beyond this point, they take away the relationship of Christ's death and His resurrection in partaking the Lord's Supper. For Paul said, as oft as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show forth the Lord's death till He come again. Then there's the teaching of those who practice the one cup. That was dealt with somewhat last night. And this, as was mentioned last night, does not have to be a test of fellowship. But if they bind it upon us and will say, yes, this is all you can do, then it does become a test of fellowship. Because the Bible does not so teach. In fact, many of those who teach that doctrine say indeed that there are three elements. There is the cup, the fruit of the vine, and the bread. But the Lord's Supper, the Word of God, only gives us two, the fruit of the vine and the bread. Of course, the cup that Jesus speaks of is indeed not the literal cup, but the fruit of the vine itself, in which they were to partake of. Then there are those in the liberal camps who would say that all that we have to be united in is just in the belief in Christ as the Son of God. And that we do not have to be united in those things that they call doctrine. Yet we find that Jesus said the devils knew who He was. James said the devils believed and trembled. Are we going to have fellowship with devils? Paul condemned that in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. These false teachers teach that subjects like marriage, divorce, baptism, the oneness of the church, the Lord's Supper are just optionals, matters of opinion. Or they are doctrine. They make a distinction between the word gospel, the word doctrine. The gospel relates to the deity of Christ. And doctrine relates to everything else. They say we ought to teach the gospel to those who have never obeyed the gospel, lost in the world, and just hold the doctrine within our respective churches, and then we can preach or teach whatever doctrine we want to teach and where we're at. But again, the Bible doesn't teach that. Brother Global Music, in his book, A Critical Study on a Critical Subject, Fellowship, in pages 21 and 22, gives six quotations from Bible scholars showing that the word doctrine used in 2 John 9 applies not to the teaching about Christ, but to the teachings of Christ. Paul was to preach the gospel to those at Rome. Was Paul going to only teach these at Rome that are already in the church about the deity of Christ? Any casual reading of the book of Romans would prove that that was not true. Therefore, as we think about this subject of the fellowship of the Lord's Supper, those two things, the points that were made in the beginning,